Let me just start with kind of your name, rank, and in this case, wait time.
My name is Rachel McNeill. I was a sergeant in the Army, and I was medically retired in 2010. The most recent notice of disagreement that the VA acknowledged was over 800 days ago. While I was in Iraq, I worked in the burn pits for a little while, and I was doing work with convoy security, and so had exposure to combat and had IEDs go off nearby. And so I've had symptoms and related to that, and I filed a claim, and they denied it. So I began the appeals process, and the appeals process just kind of goes on perpetually until they decide that they have enough evidence.
My name is Aaron Thorson. I was a captain in the Army until 2011 when I exited out, transitioned into civilian life. I waited 405 days for my disability claim to go through. I originally went to the doctor for lower back pain. It's kind of a chronic thing among helicopter pilots to develop lower back pain. I was originally going looking for physical therapy, but it didn't really solve anything. So after a couple years of doing physical therapy with the Army, they finally did an MRI. I have a crushed disc in my lower back. Surgery was an option. We began some pretty intensive physical therapy.
I'm Zach McIlwain. I was in the United States Army. I was a staff sergeant. I deployed in Iraq in 2005, or 2006, 2009. And when I got back, I filed my claims, and yesterday was my day 980. I suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder, and due to my combat awards and my awards for service and duty on the battlefield, I was able to get that claim and push through easily. I know that's not the case for all people, and I'm sure we can go over that. But the bad was paperwork. They kept losing my medical documentation. I kept handing it off to them, and somebody would lose it. And then, in fact, one of my claims was denied, because even though I'd handed them the paperwork, they lost it and denied my claim for failure of receipt of paperwork. So I sat just with the paperwork in hand, trying to navigate the appeals process, just find somebody that I could hand the paperwork to. I mean, it was as simple as just, here's the paperwork.
What's the most difficult part about this process for you?
It was trying to get a hold of somebody to talk to at the Department of Veterans Affairs, calling in and trying to get somebody that could walk you through where you were at and see and check on the status of it.
There's just so much data, so many people, so many moving pieces that it's hard to keep track and really get a feel for how you're supposed to maneuver through this process.
I spent a lot of time on hold. You know, I can't even imagine how many hours of my life I've actually spent on hold at the VA. They'll pass you around to different departments and nobody can help you, and you know, then you'll get hung up on because somebody just drops your call. You know, it's a totally incoherent process. They lose the paperwork, that's a problem. You know, they repeatedly have asked for proof of service from me, you know, and I don't know how many times I've sent them my DD-214. You know, so it's just really just the bureaucracy itself is pretty difficult to navigate.
We need access to care, we need access to, you know, all of these resources, and we have to come home and fight for it. It's not an easy thing.
I volunteered to do convoy security where I knew that something could happen. I did that having faith that if anything happened to me, you know, you'd be taken care of. And then seeing not only my situation get worse trying to deal with the VA, realizing that they weren't actually there, but also watching them do the same thing to people that I served with, people who I knew that needed help and couldn't get it. You know, like, I don't know, that's just the hugest betrayal. You know, it's really hard to rationalize that and to accept that. And what do you do? You know, where do you turn? Like, this is the institution that's there specifically not to leave you behind.
You feel left behind?
Yeah, I mean, why should you have to fight? Why should you have to fight for your benefits? You know, I went to war. I did what I had to do.
Relatively speaking, do you three feel luckier than some of these friends that you're describing?
I mean, it's just 300, 400, 500, 900, 1,000 days, years that people are waiting for these claims and processes. It's just, I feel lucky that I had the opportunity to be here and get the attention of the VA to fix my claim. But let's not forget that there's nearly a million other veterans waiting for their claims to be processed.
It's the people with the invisible wounds, the people with mental health issues that have had issues when they were in the military, and we're seeing some good professionals that could help them, and then they leave the Army and then have to wait for the Department of Veterans Affairs. And those are the ones that worry.
So the VA says, listen, we had a surge of our own, 900,000 plus veterans that have joined our roles just in the last 4 years. What do you say to that?
It's their job to meet that need. You know, we went to war. In my unit, we created armor out of scrap metal. You know, we adapted. We went in there and we did what we had to do. And the VA has options. You know, they have money. They have the ability to meet these needs. And if they can't, they have the ability to have civilian doctors meet these needs. You know, this is not an intractable problem. There's no excuse. I see friends that, you know, they are dealing with invisible wounds, TBI, PTSD, and they're not getting the help they need. And they won't even go to the VA anymore because they don't want to go through that again. You know, they went to the VA thinking the VA was going to help, and in some cases the VA turned them away when they were suicidal, when they were really, really struggling, and it took a lot for them to walk in that door. So when they leave and they don't want to go back, there's a serious problem with that, and there's no excuse.
Did any of you feel like giving up?
I don't think I ever, I was never really going to follow through, but I had my moments where I was in a dark place trying to find, seek resolution and figure out, you know, it's hard to talk about and it's hard to admit to, but I had my moments where I questioned, you know, what kind of future I really had.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of hopelessness going around in the veteran population.
What would you do to help fix this?
I think that the first step is definitely acknowledging, you know what, we have a problem. I can't even walk into the VA with not just my experiences with the disability process, but like actually witnessing them turn away one of the people who was on my gun truck team when he was suicidal, when I went there with him to get help. You know, I can't walk into the VA without thinking about that.
It's a systemic problem that Vietnam veterans are still struggling with. We're trying to navigate through, and they still have open claims. I think it's transparency. Being able to look and view and see and help work with the department to solve the problems. Because we want to solve this problem so that, you know, heaven forbid, you know, down the road there's another conflict. Those veterans don't get pushed down the line because, you know, we still have a backlog of Iraq and Afghanistan veterans with PTSD and traumatic brain injury.
If everybody's behind this and everybody's making the push, then we can, you know, figure out what the root problem of all this is, not just fix the causes, but, you know, have an honest, open debate, a discussion, you know, tear away the layers and look at it from a perspective of let's fix this as one people, you know, and make this backlog go away in the backlog.
If I could take a message from you to Secretary Shinseki, what would it be?
It needs to be fixed, and it needs to be fixed now. We don't have time.
Yeah, there's no time. And we can't afford for this to happen, to continue to happen. There's 22 veteran suicides every day. And there's people out there that need help.
We want to help the VA achieve their goal, because we all have the same end state, to give the best care to our veterans. And so please help us help you reach that goal.
I'll believe it when I see it, and I hope to see it.
And it's difficult to see that there's a new plan that's going to suddenly solve this backlog by 2015, when we haven't seen this. And this backlog, you know, of all the new veterans coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan was a completely predictable problem. You know, where was the plan back then? So it's difficult to believe that there's a plan now that's going to suddenly solve the backlog.